Hello there, and welcome back to construction grammar and its application to English. In this video, I will talk about construction morphology. So far, most examples of constructions that I've given you have been either simple words or they have been combinations of words. So phrasal constructions like the noun phrase constructions or argument structure constructions like the ditransitive construction. Now, construction grammar, it is important to point out, is more than a theory of syntax. Of course, it has developed out of a generative syntactic theory. So in a way, syntax is a privileged topic of research there. But nonetheless, the aim of construction grammar, you will remember, is to model everything that speakers know when they know a language. So we want to model everything that speakers know, not just syntactic knowledge, although syntactic knowledge, of course, is a central part of that. To date, most research done in construction grammar, in fact, addresses syntactic constructions. So you might get the idea that construction grammar is all about syntax. But in fact, there are a few approaches in recent times that develop research areas in morphology, morphophonology, so the lower levels of linguistic organization. So what is the role of morphology in construction grammar? If you really want to get to the bottom of this, I highly recommend you have a look at this book here, Construction Morphology. Most of the ideas that I'll discuss in this video come straight from this book. And so if you don't understand something that I present here, well, do yourself a favor, go to the source. Now, let me present to you a few morphological constructions. How do we even think of constructions that are morphological? Well, think of something like the plural construction. Yeah, plural formation in English, that's a construction. You have one wug, and now you have two of them. You have two, well, wugs. Yeah, you knew that. Also, word formation processes, like suffixation with a suffix like -able. That's a construction, yeah? So we might call this the viable construction. If you tell somebody, well, I'm Skypeable all morning, then you have successfully applied the viable construction to a new verbal stem, namely Skype. Then blending, you're familiar with that, I guess. Blending is also a construction. We have to rethink blending as a construction. If you have a word like spants, yeah, they're not quite shorts, not quite pants. If you put them together, there's spants. And then another morphological construction that I'll discuss in just a few minutes' time is the phrasal compound construction. So in English, there are words like over-the-counter drugs. There are good reasons to view these as compounds. They share certain structural characteristics with compounds. But then again, you notice that the non-head element, over-the-counter, has the shape of a phrase, not a simple word. And that makes them a little iffy. Right, so these are the phenomena that we would like to explain using the tools and concepts of construction grammar. How do we do that? Well, let's look at them one by one and consider the question why we would want to look at them in terms of constructions. So why, for instance, is plural formation in English a construction? Well, going back to the very first video, something that I said was that constructions are generalizations that speakers make. Yeah, something that speakers know about their language, some generalization. And indeed, it seems that with plural formation, speakers have made such a generalization. So even words that they hear for the first time, they can pluralize. Yeah, there's the famous wug test. And children of quite a young age master this wug test. Of course, we can think of plural formation as a construction that has a meaning that corresponds to a certain form. So the meaning, trivially, would be more than one. Yeah, and the form would consist of a noun plus an ending. Yeah, and this ending can be either a voiced z, a voiceless s, or of a vocalized ending is. Yeah. So the choice of which form you choose, you know all about this, is determined by phonological characteristics of the noun. What is the element in which the noun ends that determines which ending you choose? And speakers know this, and speakers apply this kind of rule. Yeah, generalization is a kind of rule. They apply this quite successfully. So, plural formation, that's a generalization across a meaning and a form. And a further construction-y detail there is that the plural construction has what we might call idiosyncratic constraints. Namely, not just any old noun will do. It has to be a count noun, or at least mass nouns are markedly dispreferred. You can talk of milks, well, in certain contexts, informations, strongly dispreferred, researches, again, in certain contexts, but not in many. Right. Then, of course, sometimes this preference for mass nouns can be overridden. You can easily say something like, three beers, please. Yeah, beer is a mass noun. And the reason you can easily say, three beers, please, and be understood, is that the principle of coercion is at work again. Coercion, you remember, if a lexical item is semantically incompatible with its morphosyntactic context, the meaning of the lexical item conforms to the meaning of the structure in which it is embedded. In other words, the construction wins out with regard to meaning. And so the mass meaning of beer is suppressed in favor of a countable meaning, which is characteristic of the plural construction, which denotes several individuated items. Okay, so if you are a very inquisitive person, then you might say, okay, if this works with beers, then why the heck does it not work with informations? Yeah, why can't we say three informations, please, if we want three items of information? Well, here's a little preview on a concept that we will discuss in a later video, the one on psycholinguistics, namely statistical preemption. Statistical preemption is, a cousin concept in morphology is called blocking. Yeah, so you can't say gooder because there already is a word better. And with informations, well, there is a plural like form pieces of information that speakers say fairly often. So imagine that you're a child and you learn the word information, and now and again you observe adult speakers say pieces of information, and you wonder, well, why don't they just say informations? That would be much easier, much faster, much more economical. But nonetheless, in every situation where you might expect informations, there they go again, saying pieces of information, or just information, yeah, as a mass. So over time, you get the idea that, well, if they're doing it systematically, it must be that there is some kind of constraint at work. It must be that they're doing this for a reason. And this reasoning is called statistical preemption. We'll say more about this later. Okay, moving on to derivational construction, Skypeable, yeah? Skypeable, foldable, washable, and so on and so forth. This is a construction that carries the meaning that something can be verbed, yeah? So something that's foldable can be folded, someone who is Skypeable can be Skyped, and so on and so forth. Typically, suffixation processes of this kind are understood as word formation processes, yeah, or word formation rules even sometimes. Now, if a word formation process is productive, it means that it's a rule that allows speakers to create new words from existing linguistic material. So you take the word Skype, you take the suffix -able, you create a new word, Skypeable. Now, what's construction like? about this. What's the view from construction morphology? In a constructional view of these things, word formation processes correspond to generalizations that speakers have made, that you can, in fact, combine a suffix or a prefix with words of certain kinds. Yeah, so speakers associate a schematic form, so say a verb together with able, with a schematic meaning, like X can be verbed. like this here. So you would have a transitive verb suffixed with able that translates into the meaning something can be verbed. Why would we want to call this a construction rather than a word formation process or a word formation rule? Well, it turns out that there are certain unpredictable characteristics about this, the kind of unpredictable characteristics that the Goldberg 95 and 2006 definitions would ask for. So what's unpredictable about the form? So for one thing, able just combines with a certain type of word. It just combines with transitive verbs, not with other verbs or with other parts of speech. So certain words like sleepable, hotable, underable, streetable, they are not words. Yeah, I just made them up. Although you might think, well, why are these not words? Yeah, sleepable, you could get some sense out of it. Well, this bed is sleepable. You can sleep in it quite well. Or something is hotable. Yeah, you can make it hot. It's safe to make it hot. Say, you know, if you have some plastic cups and you're asking, can I put these into the dishwasher? And somebody else says, yeah, they're hotable, no problem. No, doesn't work. Likewise, there are a few things that are unpredictable about the meaning. So why is there this passive interpretation, can be verbed and not can verb? Is there a reason for it? Why does sleepable not mean somebody can sleep? Or washable, somebody can wash? It's not predictable from the parts of the construction. It's rather something that is idiosyncratic. Then sometimes we also see that there are intransitive verbs inserted into the construction. So we have laughable and livable. Yeah, laugh and live, those are not transitive verbs. And laughable means something like can be laughed at, but it in fact means more than that. It means something is ridiculous. Livable means something, okay, if you're paid a certain wage and that wage is livable, you can live on that wage. It's semantically very, very restricted. You can't say it of, say, potatoes is something that you can live on exclusively. Yeah, if you eat enough potatoes, or if you drink enough beer, you can live on that. But you can't say beer is livable. That doesn't work. Okay, and then, more seriously perhaps, there are quite a number of transitive verbs that do not seem to participate in the construction. So take, run-of-the-mill transitive verb, get, make, have. Yeah, why not takeable, gettable, makeable, or haveable? With haveable, you might argue, okay, available is there, it might block it. Gettable, same thing. But takeable and makeable, why not? Perhaps if you're a native speaker and you're saying, well, takeable, makeable, they're not so bad. I could say that. Well, turns out speakers are remarkably reluctant. Maybe these occur, but very, very rarely. So, bottom line, lots and lots of idiosyncratic traits about this Skypeable construction. Spans, yeah. This illustrates a word formation process that's called blending. The usual suspect examples that are always given are motel, brunch, spork, and the like. And I would like to bring up an issue here that I discussed last time in the Constructicon video, namely could blending be a meaningless construction, a generalization that is purely formal and not meaningful? Remember, the problem that I discussed was constructions are viewed as meaningful for meaning pairings. Yeah. So if we have generalizations that are either purely formal or purely meaningful, but not associated with any form, then construction grammar is really in trouble. So is blending an embarrassment to constructional theory? Well, it's clearly a formal generalization. Yeah, there is an unpredictable aspect to the way blends are formed. There is something called the blending rule, which allows you to take two words and squish them together, taking the beginning of one word and the end of another. That's expressed here by AB plus CD blends into AD. Yeah, spork from spoon and fork, just in case. And this blending process is sensitive to syllable structure. Let me show you a few, a little graph here. Yeah, this is from Ingelplack's word formation book, by the way. And here's an observation. If you ask people to blend goat and sheep, they will come up with geep very often, and not so very often with gope. And you might wonder, well, why is that? Is that just coincidence? Well, probably not. If you ask them to blend spoon and fork, they'll give you spork, but not spork. Okay, maybe that's a bad example, because spork, that's something that you could have heard before. But nonetheless, shorts and pants gives you spants, but not shorns or shants. So there are regularities, and usually what happens is that speakers combine the onset of one word with the so-called rhyme of a second word. The rhyme comprises the nucleus of a syllable and the coda. But if you wanted to make spork, yeah, you would have to take spoo from spoon and erk from fork. That is, you would take the onset and the nucleus from spoon and just the coda of fork, and so you would break up the rhyme in both spoon and fork, and that is something that speakers are very reluctant to do. So blends usually don't separate the nucleus from the coda. That's the so-called blending rule. There are exceptions, but there are not so many. And well, this is constructional knowledge par excellence, yeah? So here's a formal generalization that speakers have internalized that works across many examples. And you might wonder, well, is this then a meaningless construction? Again, remember I outlined two ways out of this problem, yeah? One way being the prototype and extension approach. So you might say, well, motel is the prototypical blend, and then we have other words that mean other things, but that also participate in this formal generalization. Not very successful in this case, I would say, because blends mean so many different things. The second way out, I find more successful in this case. So you could come up with a very schematic meaning for blends, namely that they always denote some kind of chimera, yeah, an idea that overlays two pre-existing ideas to form some kind of monster, yeah. And here's a monster. Well, how would you call it? Most people say chickadile. Chickendile. It's also popular. And there are clever people who say crocken, yeah. But that usually comes as the third or fourth option, not as the first one. Right, blending. Next example, just as fun. Over-the-counter drugs. In English, there are endocentric noun-noun compounds in which a non-head noun combines with a head noun to form words like blackbird, limestone, shark skin, and so on and so forth. And what characterizes these forms is that they have stress on the non-head element, yeah, the first element, blackbird, limestone, shark skin. And there are good reasons to assume that these words are lexicalized, so they form part of your mental dictionary. And as we shall see in a few minutes, that causes some problems if you consider phrasal compounds that are similarly constructed. So they consist of a non-head and a nominal head, but the non-head is not a single word, it's rather a phrase. And there are different kinds of phrases there. So you get things like over-the-counter drugs, Me Too bans, or a God is dead approach. And they are like ordinary compounds in that the stress is on the non-head elements. Yeah, so you'll have Me Too bans, a God is dead approach. Which raises the question, if they have the stress pattern of lexicalized compounds, are these guys also lexicalized? And that is a problematic question, because it turns out you can play around with them. Yeah, you can not only have a God is dead approach, you can also have a well, John, he's been an advocate of a let's eat our vegetables approach, or let's take a nap before we hit the club approach. So if it is the case that you can plug in different kinds of phrases and you can make up those phrases as you go, yeah, then means that these phrasal compounds need some connection to the mental grammar, not just the lexicon. So again, these phrasal compounds are really, really difficult to explain if you assume a dictionary and grammar approach of linguistic knowledge. So that's what makes them really fun. From a constructional approach, because construction grammar is not usually considered a very elegant theory of linguistic knowledge. But in this case, actually, it provides a rather elegant solution, because it says, well, syntax, these phrase patterns, and compounds, these morphological constructions, they're really cut from the same cloth. So if we have something like phrasal compounds, we can, through multiple inheritance, generate new constructions. So phrasal compounds inherit the stress pattern from endocentric noun-noun compounds, and they inherit the internal structure of the non-head from a general phrasal construction. So let me show you this in a kind of graph here. So we have in our constructicon a noun-noun compound construction, and we have in our constructicon a prepositional phrase construction. And phrasal compounds inherit from the noun-noun compound construction the stress pattern and also aspects of the structure, so that the second element is the head noun. But from the prepositional phrase, we inherit the internal structure of the non-head, yeah, the phrasal structure. Multiple inheritance yielding a fairly elegant solution to this puzzle. Okay, so those are morphological constructions. Now you have an overview or a first idea of what they are. And in the rest of this video, I want to do two things. First, I want to talk about morphological constructions and their properties. And then at the end of the video, I will talk about a question: how can a constructional view of morphology solve certain problems that are difficult to explain otherwise? But let's talk about morphological constructions and their properties first. So, in order to do that, I need to come back to a distinction that I made earlier, namely the distinction between constructions and constructs. So, if I say we have a morphological construction, the verber construction, yeah, with a verb, suffix, er, together they form a noun, and that means somebody who verbs. Yeah, that's instantiated by baker, swimmer, smoker, teacher, and so on and so forth. And I defined constructs as instantiations of a construction. So baker, that's an instantiation of the verbal construction. Yeah. The crucial question now is, are baker, swimmer, and so on and so forth, are they constructs or are they constructions in their own right? What do you think? If you want to think about it, you know, pause this video and, okay, I'll go ahead now. So, there are reasons to say that some of these words are in fact constructions in their own right because they have non-predictable meaning. So a teacher is somebody who teaches professionally, yeah, as a vocation. A smoker is somebody who smokes habitually, not just once every 10 years. So if there are these, and also a smoker is a smoker even when they're not currently smoking, yeah? So you don't need to have a cigarette in your mouth in order to be a smoker, as long as you regularly put a cigarette in your mouth and light it. Okay, so that means some instantiations of the verbal construction are constructions in their own right. They inherit stuff, but they also have idiosyncratic stuff. But then there are instantiations of the verbal construction that are not conventionalized and not redundantly stored, those that are made up on the fly with new verbs. So, to give you an example, here is a drawing from the late 50s of the last century from a rather famous study, the Wog study. And here you see a man who knows how to zip. What is he doing? He is. He said it. What would you call a man whose job is to zip? Right. There you have an instance of the verbal construction that is not conventionalized, that you did not have in your mental lexicon 3 minutes ago. Unless, of course, you've seen this before. But even then. Okay. With that, let me come to the properties of morphological construction. One such property is productivity. Productivity, difficult concept. Yeah, but nonetheless, let me have a go and define productivity for our purposes here. The productivity of a morphological construction describes the degree of cognitive ease. Yeah, how easy a time do you have to produce or process new complex words on the basis of that construction? Let me illustrate that a little bit. So on this definition, productivity is a gradient characteristic. Constructions can be a little productive, somewhat productive, quite productive, very productive, super productive, completely productive, or not productive at all. And there are some constructions that readily allow speakers to coin new words. So if, say, we have a verb paddle, yeah, and I have just developed a revolutionary new sports paddle that allows athletes to paddle faster and faster. And I said, well, these new paddles, I've adjusted them to the body mass index of the paddlers so that the grip is really good and also the size is adjusted so the paddlers are well-equipped and will out-paddle all their competitors. So I've used the word paddler here, and you understood what I meant. Also, if I give you a word like festiveness, you may have heard this before, you may not, but you can figure out what that means. So, verber and adjectiveness, those are very, very productive constructions in English. And then some constructions hardly allow any new formation. So nounship, the nounship construction that gives you lordship, citizenship, leadership, and so on and so forth, somewhat more restrictive, even more restrictive, the nounier construction, harpooner, cannoneer. You can kind of, you know, if say, John is our best laptopier. You know, he throws laptops at everybody. That works, but it works in the tongue-in-cheek kind of way. Here's an example of a not so very productive construction, namely the adjective en construction. You can form verbs in English with an adjective and en, and that gives you weaken, widen, tighten, soften, broaden, and so on and so forth. And in this table here, I have retrieved all examples of this construction from the British National Corpus. And you see that there are a couple of them, but not so many. 44 in total. These 44 different types, that's called the type frequency of this construction. And if you have a low type frequency, like 44, that's not so much. That is already some kind of indication that it may not be as productive. If, you know, through time, all that speakers have come up with are 44 different types, can't have been that productive. Thousands, well, yeah. But notice that type frequency just tells you part of the story. What most corpus-based measures of productivity are sensitive to are types that occur with very, very low token frequencies. You see the token frequencies in these tables. With the adjective en construction, there's only one form in the BNC that occurs only once. So forms that occur only once, they're called hapax legomena. Usually when people identify productive constructions, what they're looking for is, does this construction occur with many, many types that occur only once or only twice? And the reason for this is, well, if there are large numbers of hapaxes or large numbers of low token frequency types, then that is evidence that speakers feel free to play around with this construction, that they try out new things and they may not catch on, but nonetheless, you feel free to mess around with this construction, to try out new things. And that is, in a way, a definition of productivity. Right, I just wanted to show you this. So then, we have established that the adjective en construction is not very productive. Few types, and of those, only one that is a hapax. So if there is no evidence of current productivity, should a schema such as the adjective en construction be called a construction? Should that even be a construction? Yeah, if we have no really evidence that this is a generalization that ordinary speakers make. And I leave it to you to ponder this question. I have an idea, but I'll leave it to you to think about this. Is the adjective en construction really a construction? Second property of morphological construction, they are paradigmatically organized. Now that sounds more terrible than it actually is. There's a traditional idea of paradigms. A paradigm is the set of forms that constitutes all possible inflections of a word. So in a language like English, well, English has poor inflectional morphology for a verb like walk. We have walk, walks, walked, walking. That's pretty much it. That is shameful compared to even neighboring languages. Adjectives, we have sweet, sweeter, sweetest. So not much going on there, but those are paradigms. The view from construction grammar is, well, paradigms are important because they reflect subpart links in the constructicon. Now recall last time I talked about subpart links, the kind of links that interlink constructions that have formal parts or semantic parts in common. So paradigmatic organization in construction grammar then would look like this. We have words like reports, reported, reporter, reportable, misreport, report. These instantiate the present tense, third person singular construction, the past tense construction, the verbal construction, the verbable construction, the misverb construction, misverb, and the deverbal noun construction. Yeah, and all of these share a subpart link to the verb slot that is filled by a report here. So you notice here that's a little different from the traditional idea of paradigms because, well, we don't just have verbs in there. We also have, for instance, a noun in there. And we also have adjectives like reportable or nouns like reporter. Okay. Why then are paradigms important for the constructional view of morphology? Well, it turns out they allow solutions to difficult cases for other approaches to morphology. So, how do we form a word like solipsism? If we look at alpinism and alpinist first, the way to form these words would be thought of in a way, okay, we have an adjective alpine pertaining to the Alps or pertaining to mountains in general, and then we have this ism suffix and the ist suffix, and we take the adjective alpine from the mental dictionary and stick on ism, and there we have a new word. Great. Works for alpinism, works for communist. But look at deism, fascism, solipsism, or deist, fascist, or solipsist. Now, there is no word fasch. It's not a complete word. And that poses a little problem, because in order to form fascist or fascism, we would have to let this half word fasch into the mental dictionary. And usually, no, the dictionary is just there for complete words. So what do we do? Well, in the constructicon, that's not too much of a problem, because there's no need to have fasch. You can have fascism, yeah? And fascism shares subpart links with alpinism, communism, deism, solipsism. And so alpinism, communism, deism, and so on and so forth, they share subpart links with alpinist, communist, deist. Yeah, so all of these words are interlinked, so that if you hear a word like fascism for the first time, you already can infer that there is a word like fascist. Yeah, I let this sink in for a while. If I tell you that there is an art called ventriloquism, you know that there are people who would be called, yeah, ventriloquists. And now go look it up on Wikipedia or somewhere. Okay, this is not just an isolated case, this alpinism-alpinist puzzle, but we also have it in basically all cases where we have stem allomorphy. Stem allomorphy, if you have pairs like theory, theoretic, apology, apologetic, energy, energetic, you notice that the stress pattern is different in theory, where it's on the first syllable, and theoretic, where it's on the penultimate. Now, if you have a word homiletic, you already know that there must be a noun homily. Okay, how do you know that? Well, you know it through the subpart links that occur, that link theory and theoretic, apology, apologetic, energy, energetic, and so on and so forth. So you can just fill in the blanks, do the math, and your constructicon allows you to figure out that there must be a word homily. A third property, non-compositional meanings, all-time favorite. So there are lots and lots of transparent morphological constructions, and you might argue that, well, for the most part, morphology is really transparent, it's trivial. Yeah, the meanings that come out of it, nothing much to write home about. In the past tense construction, we have walked, typed, printed. That is all very predictable. Unhappy, unfair, undeserved. Yeah, what's going on? But some morphological constructions exhibit non-compositional meaning. For instance, again, let's look at the verbable construction, comparable, honorable, agreeable. That does not just mean can be compared or can be honored or can be agreed upon, but rather something that's two things that are comparable are similar. Somebody who's honorable has to be honored because they are intrinsically, I don't know, honest and accomplished and whatnot. And something that's agreeable is very pleasant. So these, you might say, well, those are lexicalization effects. They used to be transparent, but then in the long run, they change their meanings a bit. Okay, granted. But what about things like moth-eaten or husband-dominated when compared to moth-eating or husband-dominating? Here, well, if something is moth-eaten, we know that it has been eaten by moths, or moths have eaten holes into it. Husband-dominated, well, that is said of a wife dominated by her husband. Conversely, moth-eating, that's an animal, presumably, eating moths, and husband dominating, well, that's the wife dominating the husband. How do we know that? Well, it seems that this is a non-compositional effect that results from this particular combination of two words and then the respective participial suffix. A fourth property, simultaneous affixation. This is something that is a little problematic also for other approaches. Usually the way affixation is thought about is that it works affix by affix. So if you have a word like neo-formalist, you can break that down into, well, you combine form and ul to get formal, you combine formal and ist to get formalist, and then you combine neo and formalist to get neo-formalist. So at each step of the way, you know exactly what the new suffix is. But there are problematic cases, like decaffeinate. So you can rule out that the first suffix, the first affix to join caffeine is D, because there is no such word as decaffeine. But there really is also not a word caffeinate. Well, there is a word caffeinate. You can say things like, let's get caffeinated, but, well, decaffeinate is in the OED, caffeinate is not. Just saying. So what about caffeinate? It's unlikely to be the base for decaffeinate. What construction grammarians have proposed, and this is from the construction morphology book, is that you have constructions with simultaneous affixation. So you have a nominal base, X here, to which you can add I's and at the same time D, and thus that construction means to dismantle X. So you can demilitarize a country, you can demythologize intellectual enterprise, you can de-Stalinize a regime, and so on and so forth. Right, I want to finish this, so let me briefly talk about constructional solutions to morphological puzzles. And the puzzle that I want to talk about is why some affix sequences are impossible. So you can form words like activize, yeah, with iv and eyes, collectivize, relativize, that works. But the opposite order is not possible. Generalizive, yeah, the quality of being able to generalize, or specializive or stabilizive, no, those are not words. And the question is, why are these not words? Why can't we say them? well, why can't you say stabilizive? A first thing to ask would be if maybe my examples are just handpicked and there could be some words, other words ending in isive. Well, you can start a little search, no? Take your time, but don't be disappointed if you don't come up with anything. Then you might say, well, stabilize if that is not a word because it's just an odd idea, an idea that speakers don't need to lexicalize. And again, well, there are other ideas that are really odd and still they get lexicalized, so I'm not sure whether I'd buy that argument. And then you might say, as a third line of attack, well, the verbive construction is quite unproductive by itself. And it's strongly constrained, so You have active and collective, but you don't have thinkive or discussive. So really, there's just not much going on. Well, and there are other explanations that you could possibly think of. But one explanation that I would like to present to you is the so-called complexity-based ordering hypothesis. And this has been proposed by Hay and Plog, 2004, and the core of the argument is that an affix that can be easily parsed out should not occur inside an affix that cannot be easily parsed out. So what's an affix that can be easily parsed out? Some words are easily segmented into stem and affix, like goodness or friendly. Yeah, the ness part you can recognize, the li part you can recognize. And there are other words that are not as easily segmented. So electric, yeah, the ik, or gracious, or serenity. Not as easy as ness, not as easy as li. I think that much we can agree on. Let me just move into the light a bit. Here we go, it's a bit better. All right, so when is a complex word likely to be parsed? Consider the word government and the word discernment. So we have the verb govern that occurs in the BNC some 570 times, and we have government, which occurs some 60,000 times. So government is much, much more frequent than govern. And then we have the verb discern and the verb discernment, the noun discernment, sorry. So discernment occurs some 56 times, the verb discern occurs 260 times. And you can see from this that, well, government, with government, you probably don't think twice about this being a complex word. Rather, it looks to you as one single word. It's so strongly entrenched that you forget about the internal morphological structure. With discernment, not so much. Discern, you hear much more often as a verb on its own. Discernment is therefore more transparently parsable. So, Hay and Plog asked for different suffixes, whether or not they tend to be parsed. So there are suffixes like li, as in quickly, th, as in warmth, and so on and so forth. And if you look at the types and how often the base occurs on its own and how often the base occurs with the suffix, you get an idea of the percentage of types that are parsed. And this percentage tends to be low with suffixes such as li and th. So those are not so easily parsed out. And it's very high with suffixes like full, nominal, so handful, shovelful. Yeah, hand occurs much more often than handful. Shovelful, shovel on its own occurs much more often than shovelful. So those are easily parsed out. And then what they did, they ranked these suffixes in terms of their parsability, and came up with the idea that, wow, this really represents a hierarchy of combinatorics. So you can form complex words in which you take more than one of these suffixes, but if you take more than one of these suffixes, they have to be in sequence on this hierarchy. Yeah, so you have words like strengthener, starting with th, then having en, then having er. Leadership, yeah, er, and then further down, ship. Or thankfulness, yeah, thank, then full, the adjective full, and ness. That works. But the other way around does not work. So you don't have handfuls, or goodnessling, oh my, that's a cool word though, goodnessling, or sheepishen, yeah, to make sheepish, nah, doesn't work. Right, the amazing finding is that the ratio of parsed types corresponds very, very nicely to the ranks in the suffix hierarchy. Yeah, so parsability correlates with combinability. That is the astonishing and really heartening finding here. And what this means is, why are some affix sequences impossible? Well, with activize, collectivize, relativize, the adjective slot in the adjective eyes construction is relatively transparent to speakers. But the verb slot in the verbive construction is not as transparent to speakers. And that's how you cannot say generalizive, specializive, or stabilizive. Okay, you notice it's really getting dark. And I'm coming to an end here. The next video will be about information packaging. So it will be about the pragmatic side of construction grammar. So we're jumping from morphology over syntax and semantics to pragmatics. All right.